Good morning, everybody. Warm welcome to worship. We're so glad that you could join us today. And just to make you aware again that after the service, between the services, our classes have restarted. There's a nursery open, children's ministry, youth, adult classes will be open from 10 to 10:50. On the adult level, there's three classes that we'll be meeting: the ambassador's class upstairs above the kitchen, the Journeys class, that's downstairs in the Family Life Center, F5 and F7, and then the ladies class is downstairs in F3. And then just a reminder that our children's church is now re-meeting during the 11 o'clock service. The kids are gathering together. This afternoon, we have a special program at 5 o'clock. A man named Ryan Karp, he is with Chosen People Ministries. And he's going to come this time and explain to us the book of Esther, the Feast of Purim. So come and join us. It'll be a special presentation that will happen. Afterwards, we have these little cookies they commonly eat with that celebration, and we've got those as well to share and enjoy some fellowship. There'll be a love offering given to Chosen People Ministries at that time, too. The Ladies' Bible Study that meets on Tuesday morning at 9 a.m., you're starting. This Tuesday, your study is going to be in the book of Acts, so you can start looking at that book. And next Friday from 7 to 8 o'clock, Jake and our second service worship team, they'll be leading us in a time of praise and song and scripture reading. Everyone's welcome to come and enjoy this great time of worshiping the Lord. And today is the last day to turn in those thank yous that we're giving to medical workers who serve in our community. There's two left on the table, so why don't you grab one of those two, fill it out now, because it's got to be turned in today to go out to our medical workers in the month of March. Our call to worship today is Jesus' response to Peter when Peter made that confession, "You are the Christ, the Son of the living God." And then Jesus said, "I will give you the keys of the kingdom of heaven. Whatever you will bind on earth shall have been bound in heaven. And whatever you loose on earth shall have been loosed in heaven." Let's pray. Thank you that we can gather in the name of Jesus, and we ask that help us in song, help us as we hear your word, help us as we just enjoy the fellowship together that we have with you and with one another. Enrich us greatly from this time together through your Son's name and to his glory. Amen.
The Lord said that I am the Lord, there is none other. And it's repeated in Isaiah 6 times. So let's worship with our declaration. I ask you to sing with us, standing please. I worship you, Almighty God. We're told that we're surrounded by a crowd of witnesses. May all that come behind us find us faithful. Let's sing, "Find Us Faithful."
Oh, may all find us faithful. Oh, may all who come behind us find us faithful. May the fire of our devotion light our way. May the footprints that we leave lead them to believe, and the lives we live inspire us to obey.
Originally, this song had 19 verses. Today, we're only going to sing 4. May the tongue that I speak your praises with all day long. So let's sing 1,000 tongues to sing.
Charms our fears, that bids our sorrows cease. 'Tis music in the sinner's ears, 'tis life and health and peace. He breaks the power of canceled sin, he sets the prisoner free. His blood can make the foulest clean, his blood availed for. Gracious Master and my God, assist me to proclaim, to spread through all the earth abroad the honors of thy name.
You may be seated.
Great to be able to worship the Lord together. Our spotlight today is Scott and Corey Schwartz. They have not too long ago moved to Lakewood, New Jersey, where there's a very sizable Jewish community, one of the largest communities in the United States. And so trying to reach out especially to Jewish folks there in that community. They want us to be praying for just ways to reach out to the Orthodox Jews and others who are there, asking for divine encounters that God would arrange to send people who are seeking, Nicodemus type of people who are open and seeking. And Scott just needing wisdom in how to build relationships, where to go to build those relationships. They themselves have been studying the Talmud to be more familiar with Jewish backgrounds and being able to build bridges with people. And also they're finding a number of churches in their community there that want training. And how do you share faith with Jewish people, and so they're having opportunity for that as well. They certainly want to see their family to be able to settle in that community. If your kids aren't settled, you're not very settled, and so they want to pray for that to be happening as well. So let's take a moment, go to the throne of grace, pray for the Schwartzes as they reach out, and whatever else is on your mind and heart, let's pray about that too. Father, I do thank you for the work that you continue to do, and thank you for the Schwartzes following your leading to be there in Lakewood, New Jersey. As they've requested, give them those divine encounters like Jesus had with Nicodemus, Paul had with Lydia. May there be others like that that they would encounter, ones who would be open and responsive. Father, we pray for the churches that to be equipped and be effective and want to reach out to all peoples, including the Jewish people in that area. of their country. Thank you for doing that, Father. We pray also that you would use our classes today, help each teacher on any level to be effective and used by you. Help us to not only hear, but do your word. We pray for Ryan, who can be with this afternoon, and pray that you'll be using him to minister to us, and we can be a blessing to him as well. Now, Lord, give us ears to hear what you, your Spirit is saying to us, and help us to act upon what we are hearing and seeing. Lord, we pray that this will carry us through the week and the month and the year to be faithful and true, to hold fast to what we have and what you want to give us. In the name of your Son, we pray. Amen. We were going with our son to visit colleges to check some different ones out to decide which one might be appropriate. And we came to one of them where, when we came to the building we were supposed to meet, there was actually a sign with our names on it. I don't mean some piece of cardboard that just tacked on this sign. It was an actual sign they had prepared with our names on it, personally welcoming us to the campus that day. Needless to say, we were impressed. We really felt welcomed that they went out of their way. Of course, they wanted our money. They wanted our son to go to that campus, but they really rolled out the red carpet to make us feel welcome. I think this is what we have with the church we're looking at today in Revelation chapter 3. Jesus goes out of his way to communicate, you belong, and really wanting his followers to feel welcomed. And it just resonates through this whole little letter in chapter 3 that you folks belong, you fit in, you're significant. So let's learn and benefit from this little letter in Revelation chapter 3, which picks up in verse 7 of that chapter. Following the format of all the letters on that yellow sheet I gave you that you can be filling in as we go, we begin by the question of who's being addressed, who is being written to, and that comes out in the beginning of verse 7, to the angel of the church in Philadelphia. All right, let's learn a little bit more about Philadelphia. This is about 30 miles southeast of the previous city, the previous church that was addressed, Sardius, same valley, but now 30 miles to the southeast. Philadelphia was in this transitional land in that area of Asia Minor, where they're on the eastern end of this broad valley, but you go from Philadelphia, and they're situated on a hill, and they're moving into this higher plateau area, which is moving into a different cultural area where they're at. That's significant. Just keep that in mind. They had a lot of good land there, so the vine was very productive, and of course the wine crop was very productive with that, and of course they worshipped a god of wine in their pagan worship as well. One detriment to that area of the world is it was susceptible to earthquakes, different earthquakes, and the same earthquake that destroyed this Sardis also destroyed Philadelphia in AD 17, and then they were rebuilt. But you always had the uncertainty, is there going to be another earthquake which is going to wipe us out, and the insecurity that went with that. I mentioned that they were sort of like a mission city, moving out of what was in the west of Asia Minor, moving into the upper plateau country, which was a different culture, moving into different places, and they're right on the border of that, moving into a region called Phrygia and that kind of movement. Verse 8 talks about them being little, and you wonder if maybe the church was struggling, maybe they were small, maybe they were weak, and that's the reference to the church and its experience. The description of Jesus, that's brought out in this verse as well, where it says, he who is holy and is who is true. Same two are combined with the reference to the Lord God in chapter 6, verse 10. And so when we talk about God and Jesus being holy, first of all, it means he's totally unique. There's no one like the Holy One. He is totally unique. And then it also emphasizes that he is totally separate from sin. And so that holiness comes out with Jesus. And then he is true. In classical Greek, that meant that you were genuine or real. You combine that with Hebrew thought, where the emphasis in Hebrew thought was you were completely trustworthy in your words and your actions. I think both are true. He's genuine, he's the real thing, and he also is the one who is totally trustworthy in all of his words and all of his actions as well. A church that's struggling with insecurity needs that kind of reminder. Where's the real thing experienced? Where's the one that's totally reliable and trustworthy in whatever he does and says? Well, the one who is holy and true. We are already told in chapter 1, verse 18, that Jesus has the keys of death and of Hades. Now, there's another key referred to here where it says he has the key of David, who opens and no one will shut, and who shuts and no one opens. I believe this is a reference to the book of Isaiah, in Isaiah chapter 22, beginning in verse 15. There was this person who was there, his name was Shebna, and he was the royal steward over the royal palace, if you will, and he had the keys where he could determine who would be allowed into this royal palace, who would not be allowed in. Unfortunately, Shebna was unfaithful. He wasn't reliable, and he thought he was going to be able to just stay there permanently, and God removed him. And he replaced him with another reliable servant, and his name was Eliakim. And Eliakim, this language that's quoted here, is made a reference to Eliakim in that Isaiah passage, verse 22, where it says, "Then I will put the key of the house of David on his shoulder. When he opens, no one will shut. When he shuts, no one will open." So that meant that you had the authority to allow someone into some place in the royal palace or keep them from coming into that royal palace. Of course, you move to Revelation. This is messianic. What's being referred to here is the Messiah, the Lord Jesus. He is the one who has absolute authority, who determines who will be allowed in his kingdom and who will be forbidden from being part of his kingdom. That's how we begin our worship service in Matthew 16, where Jesus said to Peter and disciples beyond that, "I'm giving you the keys of the kingdom. What you forbid on earth shall have been already forbidden." You're basically telling people what God has established, the conditions of getting in and out of the kingdom. And so what you allow, it's allowed in heaven. What you forbid has already been forbidden in heaven. So basically what's being pointed out here is Jesus is who has the one who has the authority, who will be allowed into his kingdom and who will be forbidden from becoming into his kingdom as well. Big contrast with the persecuting synagogue in this community who had it in for Christians. And so they would try to hold it over the Christians, and they would excommunicate it and had excommunicated them from their synagogues. And these Jewish people claimed, "We've got the passage into the kingdom. We've got control of the kingdom." Jesus saying, "No, I do. He's the only one that has the authority, who's allowed in and who's forbidden from coming into his kingdom." So don't be afraid of being excommunicated, ill-treated by non-believers, even religious non-believers. It's Jesus who has the keys and determines who will come in and who will be excluded. The praise comes out in the beginning of verse 8. "I know your deeds." And we see this phrase throughout these letters, don't we? I know this. And there is something that's comforting to be reminded of that reality. You're going through some tough times. It's good to be reminded the Lord knows what you're going through. He sees exactly what you're enduring. He sees what you're going through. He's seeing what you are persevering through. And I think this is very encouraging for someone who feels that they're going unnoticed. You know, I've been trying to be faithful. I've been hanging in there. I'm enduring. And I feel like I'm not being noticed at all. He notices. The Lord Jesus, he notices, and he knows all that you're going through, all that you've done, and he's got his eyes on that, and that's what really matters. At this point, commonly there is a rebuke, but there is no rebuke in this letter. The Lord loves this church. He's really glad with what's going on. There is no rebuke. Instead, what we've got is flowing out of the praise is promises, a series of promises. And we pick up with the first one in verse 8, where there's this opportunity or access that's put before the church. He says here, "Behold, I have put before you an open door." In the original language, it implies, "I have put it before you, and it's still before you." And it's a door that has been opened, and it remains opened. I have put this before you, and it remains open. There are two ways you can understand this, and both of them make a lot of sense. One way you can understand it is this is the city, as I mentioned already, was a mission city that could influence taking Greek culture and Greek language from the east or from the west to the east, to that high plateau area and beyond, which had different cultures, different languages. So the city was a mission city in the Greek and Roman world. And what could be saying here, Jesus saying, I've given you an open door for witness and ministry. And we see this reference in other places in the Bible, like in Acts chapter 14, verse 27. Paul and Barnabas given a door of faith, an open door of faith to the Gentiles. Or 1 Corinthians chapter 16, verse 9, where it talks about an open door before Paul that was given for ministry and service. And so understood that way, what he's saying is, hey, I know what you've gone through. I have put a wide open door before you for witness and for ministry where you can have great influence for me. That goes well with what follows because you have a little power. The other way you can understand it is in the context, again, against the contrast of the Jewish community that's persecuting them, excluding them from the synagogue and saying, you are not part of the kingdom of God. You are cut off. You have no access to this kind of thing. And Jesus' response is, hey, I have given you a wide open door into the kingdom of God. You are my followers. Nobody can close that door. It is wide open. You're part of the kingdom. And you are going to enter into fully the kingdom of God one day. And I've set that before you, my church, and no one can shut that door, no matter how much noise they make, no matter how intimidated they try to be, nobody can close that door for your complete access into the kingdom of God. Remember, Jesus has the keys. Really, maybe both could be true. He's talking about an opportunity that he puts before the church. Here's an opportunity for a ministry and service and witness, which no one can close that opportunity because I've opened it. And beyond that, even the greater opportunity is to have full access to the kingdom of God. And one day when Jesus establishes the kingdom in all of its fullness, we as believers, we're fully there. The door is wide open. And no one can shut that door because we've responded to Christ by faith and we have this great access into the kingdom one day. And then he gives the reasons because you have a little power. And I don't think he means this negatively. He's saying you do have a little power. You can be effective in ministry. And don't be down on yourself. You just have a little power. You need more divine power. And the Lord's willing to give more divine power. But you have a little power. And some churches have no power. And people who are not followers of Jesus Christ, they certainly have none of his power either. This church, this faithful church, you've got a little power and use it. And then in addition to that, and you have a little power, and then he also says, you have followed, it's really the word kept, you have kept my word, and you have not denied my name. Isn't that what the Lord is looking for all churches? That we can't control results, but we can keep his word. We can not deny his name. We can take the little bit of power that we have and make full use of it and be reliant that he will give us more divine power. So we can't control consequences and results, but we can take advantage of what he has given us and what he has opened before us. And he's encouraging the church in this way in terms of this first part of the promise. The second part of the promise has to do with vindication. Comes out in verse 9, behold, I will make those of the synagogue of Satan. Same kind of language was used in chapter 2, verse 9 of the synagogue at Smyrna. Because they so strongly deny the Lord, they adamantly deny Jesus as their Messiah, they're not a true synagogue. They're a synagogue of Satan that's serving and worshiping Satan. And it's showing by the way they're treating the followers of Jesus, the church. And so though they might claim to have access to the kingdom and control of the kingdom and ones that are bound to the kingdom, they're actually a synagogue of Satan. They don't have the keys. A true Jew would respond to the Messiah who was sent. And so he makes that kind of charge. And he says, of these who are a synagogue of Satan, who say that they are Jews but are not. They lie. I will make them come and bow down before your feet and make them know that I have loved you. Now, they, of course, would claim that the Lord loves us. He doesn't love those Gentiles and those people who call themselves the church. Well, they will reach a point where they will know he has loved these followers of his. This is a really powerful statement because several times in the book of Isaiah, contrary is emphasized, where the Jews would realize Gentiles will come, and Gentiles who persecuted them and opposed them, they will come down and bow before the Jews. And so really what Jesus is saying here is a turn of events in terms of what's going to happen. The Jews who insist the Gentiles will come and bow, including that church and those followers of Jesus. And so Isaiah chapter 49 describes it this way. In verse 23 describes it this way. Kings will be your guardians, and their princes your nurses. They will bow down to you with their faces to the ground and lick the dust of your feet. And you will know that I am the Lord. Those who hopefully wait for me will not be put to shame. So the Israelites would say that's going to happen to those unbelieving Gentiles who have persecuted and opposed us, kings and rulers. And now notice the tables are being turned. Where those who claim to be followers of the Lord and are not, they're a synagogue of Satan, they will come and bow down before you. And they will have to confess that I love you and have loved you. And I think this is not so much a reference to the fact that they will come to believe in Jesus, though the opportunity is there. I think what's being emphasized in this context is justice and punishment. They will be brought to the humiliating position of being bowed down at the feet of those they persecuted, and they will get the justice they deserve and the punishment that they deserve for not responding to Jesus and believing in him. And so tables are turned, aren't they? With this promise. The third promise is that of deliverance, and that comes out in verse 10, where it says, because you have kept my word of perseverance, I will also keep you from the hour of testing, that hour which is about to come on the whole world to test those who live on the earth. Seems like a bit of a contrast with what we had with the church at Smyrna in chapter 2, verse 10, where it says, don't be afraid, the devil is about to throw some of you into prison, so you will be tested, and you will have tribulation for 10 days. Now, this church is going to be delivered from tribulation, this testing. We don't know of this happening in that time era, where there was a time where there was a test. In John's time or shortly after, there was a test that came on the whole world to test them. So I think the best way to understand this is a future event pointing towards that this time of testing that's going to come. In this reference here to those who dwell on the earth, it's a phrase that runs through Revelation. And it emphasizes people on earth in that last time who are not believers, and they are increasingly becoming hardened. And they persecute and kill followers of Jesus, and that's what the reference is. It's unbelievers who are hardened in sin, those dwelling on earth at that time. What he's referring to here is what we call the rapture. And that's drawn from a Latin phrase and a word in 1 Thessalians 4:17, where the church will be caught up. And the church will be caught up and taken to be with the Lord. And so the debate is, when will that happen as it relates to the return of Jesus Christ? When will he take the church to be with himself? You'll notice the debate goes a lot around what that little preposition from means. It's a word that can mean from, it can mean out of, it can mean away from, and quite a range of possibilities. And so there's four different ways that people explain this. I'll try to be fair with each of these ways. The first way is the way that would we call a post-tribulational position. These people would say that the church is going to go all the way through the whole time period, the difficult time, the testing, all the way till the end. The Lord will then rapture his church and then immediately return to earth in glory with the church. In other words, these people are going to go through the tribulation, that tough time. What they have to do with that preposition is take it in a way that normally it's not emphasized. They have to emphasize that preposition from means kept through. There's not so much being taken out of. It's I'm going to keep you through, keep you, protect you from Satan and keep you through that time. The other three options, I think, probably fit better with the preposition that, which emphasizes being taken out of something. And I think the other three also fit well with the context of this little letter in the book of Revelation. And so the second way this could be understood is what's called the pre-tribulational rapture. And what this is saying is the church is going to be taken out. And they point to a tribulation. And they acknowledge the church throughout history always has to deal with tribulation and opposition for being faithful to Christ. But they point to a seven-year time period at the very end before Christ returns. And that will begin with the person who's going to become the Antichrist. He will make a treaty with the nation of Israel based on Daniel chapter 9, verse 27. He will make a seven-year treaty with the nation of Israel. And so, understood that way, I'm going to take you out of that. Right at that point, somewhere around before that treaty or with that treaty, I will take you out of the world to be with myself at that point. So what you're being spared from is that tribulation, that seven-year tribulation time period. There's another way that people understood it, and that would be what's called a mid-tribulation rapture. And that's at the midpoint of the tribulation, a three-and-a-half-year time period. This would go well with Matthew 24, verse 21, where Jesus said that Antichrist is going to set up an abomination of desolation in the temple, basically an idol that proclaims himself as God. Jesus himself calls that the beginning of the Great Tribulation. And understood that way, what Jesus is saying, I will take you out of the Great Tribulation, which begins with the abomination of desolation. I will take you out of there to be with myself at that point. The third way people understand the out of at this point is what's called a pre-wrath rapture. And what these individuals would emphasize that the hour of testing that's talked about here is the day of the Lord's judgments. It's the wrath of God being poured out upon the earth. And certainly beginning with the sixth seal, you've got the day of the Lord's judgments happening at that point. And what Jesus would be referring to, my church is not destined for wrath. I will take you away from the wrath of God at that point, and you will be spared at that point. Those who take this position don't try to pinpoint a specific time, just when the day of the Lord begins, when the judgments of the Lord begin, the church is taken at that point. The last three positions I've explained, all of them could understand that preposition out of. You are going to be taken out of that experience to be with me at that point. You've kept my word. I will keep you out of that at that time. You search the scriptures, see which one you think makes the most sense. And as we go along in Revelation, you think about it too in terms of what makes the most sense. But deliverance promised for his people. Then we have the call in verse 11, where he says, Jesus says, I'm coming quickly. Hold firmly to what you have so that no one will take your crown. You don't want to lose your crown of reward by not holding firmly to Jesus and what he has given. You want to hold firmly to him. And so that's both encouraging. There's this crown that awaits us, but it's also challenging. I don't want to be disqualified and lose my reward by not holding fast to my crown. And of course, the imagery of the athletic games and winning the crown for those who won those athletic games, a much greater crown awaiting his followers one day, and that's the call. In the other letters, minus Smyrna, there was at this point a warning that would happen. There is no warning to this letter, to this church, because Jesus really likes what's going on here, and so there's no rebuke and there's no warning. Instead, we have a strong emphasis on reward that comes up in verses 12 and 13 with the invitation, which happens in each letter at the very end. So notice the reward here. The one who overcomes, I will make him a pillar in the temple of my God, and he will not go out from it anymore. Keep in mind, Philadelphia was susceptible to earthquakes. Earthquakes that could wipe out the city. And when the earthquakes happened, guess what would be the only thing left standing? Pillars and temples. And so everything else wiped out. Here's a pillar in the temple that's not wiped out. Background to what Jesus is promising here. That kind of security. And also, when these earthquakes struck the city, you couldn't live in the city anymore. You had to go out into the farm country and live outward. And the reference here, you won't go out from it anymore. And maybe a little bit more background, as the expositor's Bible commentary talks about. In those days, faithful public servants and distinguished priests were honored by giving a special pillar in one of their temples with their name on it to honor those special people. So again, you're thinking that background of what happens in your city. And then you hear these reassuring words from Jesus saying, hey, you're going to be like that pillar, only more so. I'm going to make you a pillar in the temple of my God. That kind of security, that kind of permanence in your position, that no spiritual earthquake, no real earthquake can remove that kind of permanence and that kind of security. And you won't have to think, we got to run, we got to get out of here, because you're just going to stay right there. And you won't have to go out of this place that I have for you. That's the kind of reward. Folks, people are dying. I mean, emotionally, for this kind of security. For us to tell them, you can have this kind of permanence. You can have this kind of reliability. You can have this kind of welcome. And they're not finding anywhere else, but from us, they can find it. The reward of the permanence and security that Jesus offers, even though there's earthquakes all over the place, spiritually speaking and literally happening, and yet there can be this kind of security and place that God has for people. Now, we realize when we get to the end of Revelation, there is no temple in heaven. So, of course, this is symbolic. Being in the presence of the Lord, you're like that pillar in a temple. Nothing's going to take you away. Nothing's going to shake you or remove you from my presence, no matter what you have to go through at this time. And then the second reward is, he says, I will write on him the name of my God and the name of the city of my God, the New Jerusalem. So when you write the name on someone, you're basically saying you belong to that person or belong to that particular place your name is written on you. And again, this big contrast with the name of the Antichrist being written on people, which we'll pick up in chapter 13, his name being written on people, and Jesus saying, hey, for those of you who are my followers, you overcomers, I will write on you the name of my God. In other words, belonging to my God. Belonging to the New Jerusalem, which is going to come down out of heaven from God, you belong to that. You belong to that kingdom I'll establish. You'll belong to that heavenly city one day, and that can't be rocked. That can't be removed. And then he says, and my new name. I'll write that my new name on you as well. So think about that. Belonging to the Father. Belonging to the Messianic kingdom. Belonging to the heavenly city coming down from heaven one day. Belonging to Jesus and having his new name. When you got this emphasis on new name, that means more revelation of what he's like. I'll tell you, if you think Christianity is boring, you're boring. Because what Jesus is saying is, I've got stuff I want to reveal to you that will just boggle your mind. And there'll be things throughout eternity which he will continue to reveal. Why? Because that new name, there's always more to discover. There's always more to experience about the Lord, which is just amazing and marvelous and fresh. And that's what he has for us, more of what he's like. He wants us to experience and know. And so this is what he has for us. Let's develop this thought a little bit more about this sense of belonging. Maybe some of you are struggling with that right now. You've got a lot of insecurity because you don't feel like you belong anywhere. You have no sense of anywhere that you can call home. Oh, you might have a house, But there isn't this sense of feeling the security of, this is actually my home, and I don't feel insecure in this place. And a lot of people really struggle with this. A lot of people, even in the church sometimes, can struggle with, I don't feel like I'm welcomed. I feel like an outsider. I don't feel like I'm welcomed in that community. I don't feel the warmth of belonging. In addition to that, people can feel like I don't feel like there's any place for me to fit in. I feel like a pillar that's fallen rather than something that can be secure and lasting and really fitting. And I remember when I was a young teenager, I went through a membership class in our church, which the pastor taught, and I hated it. Not because of the pastor, he was fine, but because nobody welcomed me. I was in that group and nobody talked to me, nobody interacted with me, and I felt like I'm not welcomed here. I don't belong. I don't fit in. And maybe it was part of my problem too of not trying to, you know, reach out and welcome others, but it was a real struggle that I went through. And I wonder sometimes how much of that happens in the church. People feel like I don't get a sense of welcome and belonging here. I don't get a sense of there's permanence of what I can experience here and what the Lord has for me with this community. And there have been times through the years, I mean, Rachel and I are pretty social. And there have been times when we've been to social events and we did not feel welcomed at all. You know, so we would go and just talk to people because no one was going to talk to us. But we certainly have got that feeling. And if we've gone there, imagine you've gone there too, or you go to a social event, it's like, wow, I really don't feel the warmth of belonging here. I don't feel like I really can fit in here. Well, you can then begin to move this to, is that the way God is towards me as well? That I don't fit in. I'm sort of like a second-class citizen of the Messianic kingdom, but I really don't have any significance in it. I don't really fit in. I'm going to be one that's going to be run out of town and not really welcome. I'm saved, but that's about it. You see, this letter is to counter all that. It's the Lord saying to his followers, you fit in. You are welcomed. And I want you to experience the full security of that and the permanence of being part of that. That's what we want to create here, but we know that's what the Lord has for us one day when he does rapture the church. And everything that follows afterwards, it's, oh, wow, what an experience. And now the fullness of belonging and fitting in and permanence and an experience that was just going to get better as time goes on. And we just have a foretaste of it right now. And so for the Lord to say, you're secure in an insecure world. You belong where there's lots of messages that you don't belong. And there's a sense of lasting permanence in a world that is just striving for something, but there's nothing that seems permanent. And then the Lord saying, go ahead and explore and experience the fullness of my new name and everything that I've got for you. Do you feel the warmth of this letter? Do you feel the strength of it? With the messages which are so loud and clear in this world, you don't fit in. You don't belong. There's no place for you. And the Lord is saying, oh, but there is. Let's pray. Father, I thank you for this letter. I thank you for the reassurance to this message of Philadelphia. Help us to take it fully to heart in our spirits and minds. In the name of Christ, amen.
This final song is a challenge. It's a very big commitment. Would you rather have Jesus than anything? Would you sing with us? Would you stand and sing with us, please? I'd rather have Jesus.
I'd rather be his, the riches untold. I'd rather.
my privilege to invite anyone here. As the letter closed today, to him who has ears to hear, let him hear what the Spirit says to his churches. And if you're hearing the Lord speaking to you, come to me, Jesus is saying. Come to him as the Savior and Lord and God. I encourage you to come to him today and respond and be part of these rewards that he has for you and really belonging, and that won't be taken away. If you're a Christian, you feel like, boy, I don't fit in. You can fit in. The Lord wants you to experience that belonging sense that you do fit in, and he wants you to know and experience that, and he wants that to be your future as well. And if we can minister to you some way, we want to certainly be there for you in this time. So remember, the classes are happening after the service time. If you can kind of move along, kind of keep the pace moving, that would be great. But if we can minister to you spiritually, love to do that so that you can really know the Jesus that we're worshiping in this book as we study it. Lord, thank you for this time together. With those words, I'd rather have Jesus than anything. And Father, as God's people, may that be the echo of our hearts. Yes, we want Jesus, because if we have him, we have all anyway. In his name I pray. Amen.